You'd sit down any time you like.
Priest etiquette. Never sit before you're asked.
Sit down then.
Don't I come over too eager?
Well, best to hover at the door.
You learned that your first week in the seminary, boy. Sig.
Come on.
Bit of a break from smoking the Bible, eh?
Why?
Anyone work out which pick is the best smoke?
We only smoke the Lamentations. Right, miserable cigarette?
Nice room. Very clean.
Where is it you're from again, Tom?
Bourne, you mean?
Bally go backwards.
Oh, the city dog.
Bally Roberts.
Oh, we play south of Ballymoney. Kilray.
I remember a homily you did at Mass one time.
Oh, will you listen to it?
Sure, the men hold you in very high esteem.
I can feel a dig coming on.
You're very quick.
Right.
Now, you're respected, you know that. But I like those stories you tell about the countryside.
A childhood of poaching, robbing apples, stampeding cattle.
Fine education for a priest.
Priest working in West Belfast, that is, yeah.
Stampeding comes in handy down the Falls Road.
Or you see, hate me.
You miss it, though.
What?
Countryside.
I should get home to see my wee brother every month or so, but... I miss the usual. Clean air, space, all that.
Feels closer to who you are.
Aye, well, it is. No question. Something like a fish out of water working in a big city like Belfast, but it's a job, isn't it? You stop looking around at your surroundings quick enough when you figure your business is the business of the soul and all.
Business of the soul?
Ah, you know what I mean.
Learned that in the seminary too?
Aye, and you can use that free of charge.
Go on.
Well, I suppose what I'm saying is, you get on. Kilray can wait till I'm an old man.
Too many scoundrels to be saved in Belfast anyway.
Busy work, aye.
Sure, God will reward you in heaven.
And I'll be thankful, once there's wine involved.
So what's your wee brother do back home?
He's a parish priest. He's a sneaky wee bastard. You know the sort, Bobby.
Still goes poaching?
Poaching jobs. And he's younger than me by 8 years, all right.
Go on.
As a cleric, I work in a parish beside Kilray, wee hole of a place. I'm working me arse off. House calls to the elderly, mobile confessions.
The glamour stuff.
Oh, aye. So, anyway, position comes up at Kilray.
Right.
And I'm passed over for some reason or other. No reason, probably.
Taking too much cake off the old ladies.
Probably.
So?
So about 5 years later, position again comes up back home in Kilray. And my brother Michael waltzes right into it.
Fuck.
He's made parish priest at 28.
More spiritual, probably. Less lippy than you.
Mm-hmm. You work the bishop. He's a golfer. He's a pushy little twerp, is what he is.
At least you're not bitter.
Oh, no, I couldn't be that, no.
Parish priest at 28? Fantastic.
Hmm. He's two cars. And the house he has is massive. He's a maid, a cook. I'm stuck in a two up, two down, with a fat Kerry man who drones on and on about Gaelic football. Can we stop talking about this?
Jesus, you're the one who's talking.
Hmm. How's your smoke going?
Grand.
Hmm. Filthy habit. Disgusting.
Oh, aye, awful. Lovely, though.
Aye, praise the Lord.
28. My God.
Oh, stop it. So what happened to your eye, Bobby?
What?
You gotta dig for yourself, your eye.
Difference of opinion.
Hmm. How's the other fella?
Oh, that's worse. Leave me.
So, what did you call me here for?
Well, is that the idle banter over with?
Priest etiquette. Start with a small talk.
I'm learning a lot about the priesthood, Don.
Hmm, you'd make a fine priest.
Oh, aye.
Good talker, man of principle, leader of men.
Political terrorist.
The church loves a reformed crook.
Aye. I always felt that thief next to Jesus got off lightly.
Ah, but he recognised his sins.
Did he, though?
Aye, said as much.
If you're hung from a cross, you're going to say anything. Jesus offers him a seat next to his daddy in a place called Paradise. You know, he's going to put your hand up and have a piece of that.
Aye, even when it's nailed to your cross.
Jesus Christ, that's sacrilegious.
Sacrilegious?
Aye.
No, he was a dirty thief. So, what do you want to tell me? Where you at? Been driven mad by that governor yet?
See this negotiating lurk? It's been a sideshow. I tell you that for nothing.
But you understand why you need to do it?
Because we're no longer good propaganda.
According to who? The leadership?
Time has come. Decision had to be made.
You think that's what the leadership think?
Maybe, I don't know.
Bit paranoid there, Bobby.
10,000 people marched for the 7 hunger strikers last October, right?
Right.
International pressure on the Brits and all that.
Busy time.
Even the Pope's having a say, getting involved. The whole world trying to get Maggie Thatcher to back down and give us her demands, but it all came to nothing.
Right.
Hunger strike failed. We're on the front line. We created the protest. It's our responsibility. Leadership have been very clear to me, Dom. 4.5 years of the no-wash protest, as much as it's highlighted republicanism to some extent, it's also distracted from the wider development of the organisation.
That's because your needs are specific needs.
Of course they are. Some woman bringing up 3 children in West Belfast shouldn't care about civilian-type clothing or whatever the fuck they're calling these clown outfits.
That's all.
Honest to God, Dom. We were promised our own clothes. It's childish skullduggery.
So the leadership have had enough of you?
In the ideal world, we'd be fighting our battles independently, but we're tied. Nothing's changed in here. Nothing's moved on. The leadership are stuck with us until there's some realistic chance of movement towards political status. That's the hard truth of it. See, to get me to negotiate with these lying, reneging monkeys when there's never nothing on the table, it's just pure crap. I'm not going to be marched into this governor's office and get caught up in some mindless, pointless dialogue with that pompous bastard.
He's a big fan of yours.
Thick as 2 short planks, Dom. A moron. Can you believe they made him governor, though? It's a bloody insult to humanity.
Mother of Jesus, where do you get your energy from?
As a cross-country runner, as a boy.
I could have guessed it. Big engine on you. Cross-country running. Explains a lot about you, Bobby.
Well, I loved it, so did. That's the whole country thing for me. Jesus, they'd have to hold me back at the finishing line and keep on running. Little scraps who are mongrels from out of the city. Frightened of cattle and all. It was a funny time.
Frightened of cattle?
Oh, I terrified of them. Think you could get milk and burgers from them monsters? Jesus Christ. The next time around, I'll be born in the countryside, guaranteed. Wildlife, birds. And of all that, paradise.
Aye. And you could learn to relax, too.
Aye. Maybe, never know. Never tried it before. I'm starting a hunger strike on the 1st of March. That's why you're here. That's what I'm telling you.
Aye, I heard that. Does your family know?
I got word out to them, aye.
Have you spoken with them?
Got a visit in 2 weeks' time. We'll talk then.
How do you think they'll take it?
What do you think, Tom?
And your wee boy. So, what makes it different from the last time?
Last hunger strike was flawed. It became emotional. 7 men started at the same time. They all got weak and they couldn't let the weakest one die, which left us susceptible to being conned by the Brits, and that's exactly what we were, conned. This time out, the men will start consecutively 2 weeks apart. Somebody dies, they'll be replaced. There's no shortage of us. 75 men have put their names forward.
Oh, for Christ's sake.
The announcement's being made today.
So what makes this protest different is that you're set to die, Bobby.
May well come to that.
You start a hunger strike to protest for what you believe in. You don't start already determined to die, or am I missing something here?
It's in their hands. Our message is clear. They're seeing our determination.
So it'll take a couple of deaths, do you think? Maybe 5 or 6?